Thank you, Jim. I think the most encouraging thing that I've heard for a very long time is that your daughter is being taught to question the legitimacy and the adequacy of GDP as a measure, because I certainly wasn't. And I suspect she might be in the first generation of kids who are. And although I certainly couldn't claim much of the credit for that, I would certainly say it's kind of partly been brought forward by a line of thinking that I'm privileged to have contributed to. The work that Jim referred to at the SDC was a really interesting point in time, because it was a point after a sort of very robust sense that we were making progress against ecological constraints through the 90s. So the idea of ecological modernization, almost a decade actually of watching some of the indicators go in the right direction, certainly in terms of material throughput, a stabilization of global material throughput, and a little bit of a slowing down of the growth in some environmental pollutants. And then the sort of wicked problem of climate change through the first decade of the 21st century. But even that, having a sense that in the UK at least, we had by 2008 implemented a Climate Change Act that looked like it was about to get on top of those problems, whilst recognizing, of course, that the dangers were huge, the task was enormous, there was still lots more to be done. There was a couple of decades of kind of political optimism about what could be possible in relation to decoupling our economies from their environmental impacts and their resource inputs. And then it is in that context a little bit odd that the Sustainable Development Commission and myself as Economics Commissioner sat down to ask the question, well, how good actually is that? Is it going to get us far enough? What's the possibilities for taking us further in terms of decoupling? And what are the implications if we can't perhaps decouple along the lines of the technological optimism that had dominated the last couple of decades or so? And I remember very clearly the conversation that I had with Jonathan. We were both rushing between meetings in London, and he and I sat down for what was actually a very, very quick cup of coffee in a Westminster cafe somewhere. And I, at that point, had just published some work on an alternative indicator of progress, which took the GDP, took some of the things that your daughter is beginning to learn are difficulties with that as a measure, and adjusted that to see what progress might look like. And it was a measure that had been developed by Herman Daly, one of the peers of this debate about questioning growth. And it showed a very, very different pattern than the continual rise of GDP. Basically, it stabilizes from about the mid-1960s, 70s onwards, and sometimes declines depending on the country you're looking at. So in other words, a sense that when you take those things into account, those limitations, you have a very different sense of progress than the one that you have when you just look at the GDP number. And of course, what neither of us at that point really realized, firstly, was that by the time I finished that bit of work and had written the report and it was going out into the world, it was going out into a rather different world. Not only had that technological optimism sort of run into a little bit of headwinds, but the economy itself had run into an enormous firestorm, and even beyond the firestorm, a sense that there were difficulties ahead, the headwinds of secular stagnation, as Robert Gordon and Larry Summers and others have talked about it. And that has been, if you like, the most fascinating part of the journey since that first volume was published in 2009, up until the present point. That sense of a changed economic atmosphere, a changed social atmosphere, a much trickier political atmosphere, the whole experiment of austerity, and a sense really of not quite knowing where we are, even in secular terms, let alone in ecological terms or in resource terms. And so when I sat down to do a revision of Prosperity Without Growth, I think first I kind of thought I would just update a few numbers, put a few extra references in there, but the more that I looked at it and the more I began to work on it, the more I realized how much actually had changed in those intervening years. And 2009 has this almost quaint sense. For all the furore that that government report caused, particularly amongst the government ministers at that time, when it was launched in the middle of London hosting the G20 in April 2009, it has now a kind of sense of, I felt increasingly as I worked on it, a sense of overriding urgency. And it's not just an urgency in terms of climate and resources, it's actually an urgency in terms of the kind of economy that we have and the kind of society that we want. And so what I ended up doing was in a sense untangling some of the convoluted critique of the economic system and saying if we start from here, which direction should we go in and what should our steps be? And so the second edition, which has just been published, I gave it a different subtitle to reflect the fact that I had almost entirely rewritten it, was really attempting to do that. But I do just tonight, I just want to start with a little bit on the limits themselves. And I show this graph because I think it's important to say right at the start that the idea of doing without growth makes sense only in certain places. So this is a graph of life expectancy against income. And what it very, very clearly shows is that in the poorest economies in the world, on the left-hand side, you get immediate prosperity gains. You get immediate gains in life expectancy if you can increase incomes from nothing, $5,000, $3,000 per capita, to about $15,000 or $20,000 per capita. And what you can do with people's livelihoods is incredibly striking in those poorest economies of the world. And there was a point when I was looking at these data, and I'd looked at them for several years, and another graph that I show that has a similar sort of pattern is around infant mortality. And you look at a graph of infant mortality against income, and infant mortality just plummets straight down this left-hand line, and then it remains more or less flat. And the argument there for, in terms of real human suffering, for dedicating resources to the poorest parts of the world and making sure that that development happens are really, really strong. And in a sense, what that does is it creates a moral imperative for what's happening over the right-hand side of that graph. Because on the right-hand side of that graph, high consuming countries, high material footprints, a long history of impact on the environment, actually the prosperity gains are much, much smaller. So each doubling of income gives you three additional years of life expectancy in this particular statistical analysis based on UN figures. But here it's a fraction of the impact to double that income and get real gains in prosperity. And over here on the right hand side, we're chasing ever after more and more income, more and more growth with more and more impact, and it's not delivering that same sense of improved prosperity in life expectancy, in infant mortality, in maternal morbidity, in participation in education, in happiness. You can do the analysis and you see basically the same thing. So there's a sense in which growth runs out of its prosperity dividends as we get richer and richer. And we know, of course, also that I hardly need to rehearse this with you, that it also runs up against our ecological limits as we get richer and richer. And in Paris last year, or the year before last now, extraordinary political occasion, really, to even have the language of 1.5 degrees in an international agreement. And I think it was only there, basically, because none of the politicians and very few of the scientists actually realized the full implications of a 1.5 degree target. And those implications are that the carbon budget left to us, if we want to remain below that target, is around about 240 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. And we're burning that at a rate of around about 40 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. You don't have to be a brilliant mathematician to understand that within a decade, actually slightly less, we've blown our carbon budget. Now, the IPCC in its wisdom went away and said, well, we don't quite know how to achieve that. We better have a working group to look at it, which is now going to report very shortly. One thing is absolutely clear, that we're going to need a lot of negative emission technologies very, very soon. And at the moment, the technological demands on that, the economic demands on that, the social demands on that task are extraordinary. So there's a sense that those ecological limits are more at the forefront of our mind now than they have ever been before in terms of this one aspect of climate change. As Bill McKibben once said, we may not be running out of resources, but we're running out of planet. And then here is the bit of the story that is absolutely massively interesting from the perspective of what's happened since the financial crisis. Actually, it's a story that goes back way beyond the financial crisis. This is a graph of labor productivity growth from 1900 to about 2015, 2014. And what it tells is the story of growth and degrowth in labor productivity. Or not quite, it's just about degrowth. So what we're looking at is the rate at which labor productivity improves. And labor productivity is how much you can get out of people for each hour that they work in the economy. And what you see, of course, in this graph is a very, very, give or take a couple of world wars, a very steady rise in labor productivity from 1900 until around about the mid-1960s. So 1966 is the peak year of that graph, and I resist pointing out that others have also pointed out that things haven't quite been the same since 1966. But in terms of labour productivity growth, they clearly haven't. And the decline in labour productivity growth since the mid-1960s is absolutely staggering. And it was not held up by computers or digitization or the internet or Apple. It was not held up by the things that we thought we were doing politically to keep oil going in the Gulf War. It was not held up by what happened in relation to stock markets. In fact, some of those things accelerated that decline. So that by the time we got to the financial crisis, it was really right over here on the right-hand side of the graph, we're already looking at the slowing up of the possibilities for growth, which is really what labor productivity dictates. And actually, in 2014, labor productivity growth in the UK, this is a UK story, but you can look across the advanced nations and you see a very similar pattern, was labor productivity growth was negative. Now, we'll come back later to whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. But in terms of the limits to growth, in terms of the growth-based economy that we had, this is the story of what Western Europe, North America, advanced economies, even China to some extent, has been struggling against over the last decade or so. And it's a very, very different place than the place that we were, or the story that we were looking at in a sense in 2008, 2009 in the Sustainable Development Commission. It's also very interesting, of course, to see how hard politicians fight this story and want growth back again. And there's some very solid reasons for that. I mean, what happened through the crisis, of course, was not pleasant anywhere. This is a picture from North London during the London riots in 2011. It was a picture that was familiar from other European countries. It tells the story of Occupy in Wall Street and the Los Indignados in Spain and the resistance to economics across economic schools in the country, a sense that the financial crisis had given us a lesson that our economics was broken and that it wasn't meeting the demands of society. And it was a deeply dysfunctional in all sorts of ways. And when you begin to look at an economy that doesn't work, you can see where it had gone wrong. The idea that enterprise was just about the linear throughput of stuff in order to accumulate as much as possible, that work was some form of servitude, that investment is purely a form of speculation. And each one of these numbers you can back up with data. The investment of speculation is quite dramatic, that the finance essentially was financing itself. Finance was financing finance to speculate on assets rather than investing in the economy in any meaningful way. And the sense of money as a form of power in the hands of a minority. So it was a story, if you like, of the privatization of gains and the socialization of losses. And it fostered, as it well might have done, deep resentments amongst the poorest in society, amongst those excluded, amongst those left behind. And that is a story that's going on, of course, through the politics that we see around us today, as Jim half suggested in his opening. Now, my take through the work that we did at the SDC, and more so subsequently, is to ask very simply where and how we could be doing a little bit better than that. What do we start with? What are our foundations for change? What kind of work, what kind of investment, what kind of enterprise, what kind of money? Now, why do I start with those? Because they are basic economic aggregates. They are understandable features of an economy that hasn't worked. And the question is really, how could we reform those things in ways that would be meaningful for the foundations of a different kind of economy? And having articulated that, where do we then begin to build an economics that is good, that is fit for that task? So let's just start with this very simple idea, and it's one that will be very familiar to some of us in the room. The idea that actually, for the most part, what we need as human beings can be expressed as some form of service rather than material goods for their own sake. It's very, very familiar from energy. So people don't want coal and oil as such. They want the services that energy provides. What's fascinating is that that debate, which has had a 30, 40, 50 year pedigree, actually is a really applicable model to what else we're doing in the economy. You can apply it to nutrition. In food, for example, it's very, very clear that more is not always better when it comes to foodstuffs. Sometimes, actually, it's the more that's creating the lifestyle disease that's undermining the prosperity that we have, even in advanced economies. Of course, we have a sort of obscenity because there's massive undernutrition in the poorest parts of the world, but that's obscene mainly because we have poor nutrition, chronic malnourishment from having too much in the richest parts of the world. And so the idea that actually you could extend energy services towards services in nutrition, so that it's the quality of food that counts and the quality of nutrition that counts, is a really, really interesting one. And beyond that, of course, perhaps we could extend it to all the stuff that we consume. What is it that we demand from that stuff? Sometimes it is the qualities of nutrition and the warmth and the comfort. But often, actually, the pursuit of that stuff, and this speaks to a whole agenda in the sociology of consumption, the pursuit of that stuff has sociological and psychological roots in deep within the human psyche, that we care about what others think of us, and we use display to create an impression that allows us to sit comfortably with those around us. And that sense, actually, that we're using material things for social and psychological gains is, again, on the one hand, very perverse because it rarely actually delivers what we hope to have achieved through that consumption pattern. But it also offers us a kind of an idea for doing something differently, consuming less, but actually living better, concentrating on the social and psychological needs rather than on the throughput of stuff that advertisers would like us to believe will lead to the satisfaction of those needs. And it's a simple but absolutely revolutionary way of rethinking what enterprise should be doing. Beyond those social and psychological needs, of course, the services that matter to us are around health and around education, around social care, around renovation and refurbishment, around the quality of our natural environments, around the strength of our communities. And in each of these places, actually, you can see a role for enterprise that's built around the idea of performing services. So that's an idea whose foundations go back a long way, whose potential is huge, and you can also find the seeds for it in a lot of examples in many different sectors, often quite small, often community-based, often in places like this, which is a wonderful community buyout of a pub and a local shop in Norfolk, in the Norfolk Broads. And basically, if you go and visit the Norfolk Broads, you see areas of the Norfolk Broads that are just almost teeming with consumerism. And outside of those small places is where you find these little social experiments of communities who are trying to do something a little bit differently. And I'm not suggesting that, you know, the white horse at Upton is going to transform modern industry, but it is iconic. It's a sense of a different way of thinking about enterprise as a form of delivering services to others, people in the service of other people. And that brings us also to the idea of work. I mean, work is more than the means to a livelihood, and that's long been recognized. It's a part of our participation in society, a sense of the glue that holds society together, in principle, in the best jobs, in the right circumstances. But of course, the reality is very, very different for people working zero-hour contracts with very little flexibility, with no sense of continuity, with no social backup, and doing crap jobs to boot. Can we rescue that prospect for work as a meaningful participation? Can we rescue the 40 to 50% of unemployed young people that were the casualty of the financial crisis in 2008, 2009 in Southern Europe? 40 to 50%, half of a whole generation of kids growing up with long-term unemployment prospects. And the question, and I posed this question to the seminar group earlier, the question that I think is always worth asking, if you look around you in society, is there anything to be done? Are there old people in need of care? Are there small children in need of care? Are there mentally ill people who could do with more support? Are there buildings that need refurbishing? Are there communities that could do with strengthening their community amenities? Are there places where we need to protect our ecological assets? Are there places where we could substitute the simple burning of fossil fuels for something like a meaningful work? Are there trades which could do away with some of the industrialization and put in place a little bit more craft? Is there culture where we could think about the richness of our lives in terms of the contribution that people make to enriching it through art? Yes, is always the answer. I mean, I find it absolutely extraordinary, and I remember this feeling in Portugal at the time at which there was a 50% unemployment, looking at roads that were falling apart and hospitals that were falling apart, looking at schools that were under-resourced, and thinking, where on earth is the absence of work in modern society? It's absolutely clear that ability is there, that the demand is there, and that the concept of work as a way of participating in society is an incredibly powerful one. And it has, to my mind, one of the interesting things about this analysis is how much that concept of meaningful work sits closely on top of that idea of enterprise as service, because it's exactly those sectors of care and craft and creativity that calls out for this meaningful, this model of work as meaningful participation. And what's more, when you do the analysis on it, what you find is that the carbon intensity of our activities in those sectors, particularly over here, the social and personal services sector, is very, very low, and its employment potential is very, very high. In other words, what you're looking at in this graph is the possibility of going from higher carbon intensive activities to lower carbon intensive activities and employing people along the way. A place where we can tread lightly on the planet, a place where we can deliver useful services, a place where the satisfactions of those works, seen properly, can be much, much higher than in the time-poor, materials-rich, over-automated environment of throughput, fast throughput consumer goods. Now, you'll notice if you're looking at the graph closely, of course, that utilities, which is the power and energy sector, sits way out there in this graph. It's an input-output analysis, so it captures some of the fact that the outputs of these industries are being used by other industries, but utilities always sits out front as being that one place where there is a huge carbon problem to be fixed. How do we address that problem in any degree? And this is where investment comes in. I mean, I mentioned right at the beginning this idea that investment had to some extent been taken over by speculation. If you look at the graph of lending, net lending to different places, you find very, very clearly that it's dominated by lending for speculation in assets, in property, in resources, in the hedging of bets against the loss of the value of the assets, and so on and so forth, a kind of casino economy. And it seems to me that, again, what we're faced with there is saying that actually within the structures that we've created, economics has gone badly wrong. It has miscast the most fundamental relationship in economics, the relationship between the present and the future. The fact that we save at all represents a fundamentally prudential part of human nature. It says that we care about the future. It says we're prepared to defer gratification, to have some of our goodies tomorrow and sacrifice some in the present day. But for that function to be fulfilled properly, it has to be clearly an investment in the assets which will deliver prosperity tomorrow. Some of the assets, most of the assets that we currently invest in, do the reverse. They undermine prosperity tomorrow. So all of our metrics, all of our understandings, all of our portfolios, many of our pension funds are built around a kind of investment that is simply the reverse of what that relationship should be. Could we think about doing things differently? Actually, it's very, very clear that we could. The investment that's needed to bring down the utility carbon is in renewable energy technologies, in energy efficiency, in the renovation of infrastructures, in low carbon housing, in low carbon transport systems. The renovation that's needed to reduce the throughput of materials is investment in resource productivity, in service chains, in the building of schools and hospitals. The renovation that's needed to create a service section and an investment to do that is in community halls and quiet centers and gardens and public buildings and museums and places where we can, in Michael Sandel's words, encounter one another and feel as though we participate in a common endeavor. In other words, just like the work question, there is a portfolio demand for investment seen in this way. What is holding us back from that? I've worked a lot in the intervening years with different kinds of investment communities, and I know for sure that there are very, very good people out there in the institutional investment community, in the venture capital community, in community investment funds, people who are dedicated to this concept of investment and transforming the investment architecture. But I also know that at the moment that's a drop in the ocean. Often they fight against a financial system that penalizes them for taking careful investments in the future. Often they fight against the financial system that is drawing the returns of hungry savers into degrading supply chains and degrading mining operations. And that is a profound challenge, but it's also a travesty. It's a failure of government, because this investment framework, an investment framework that delivers exactly this commitment to the future, is already there and is waiting to be delivered. One of the fundamental aspects of making that work, of course, sits in the question of the money system itself. And in reaching this point, you sort of feel as though you're going deeper and deeper into the heart of the beast. You're kind of here in the heart of capitalism rests a monetary system that is simply dysfunctional. Henry Ford said in the 1930s, "I believe that if people really understood the nature of money, there would be a revolution before the morning." And one of the aspects that he was talking about is the sense in which the control over the money supply, the control over money creation, the money creation process itself, does not rest within the sovereign power of government. It has been handed over almost entirely, in fact, to commercial interests through bank lending. And there is now, and since the crisis in particular, an emerging sense that this form of money creation is destabilizing, I should say re-emerging, because actually Milton Friedman pointed it out in 1948. This form of money creation is destabilizing, is deeply inegalitarian. It creates crises from which the public sector has to rescue private sector interests who have benefited massively from it. And it robs national governments of the sovereign power to invest in the well-being of their nations. And so this idea, in fact, that money has to itself be reconceived is an incredibly powerful way of unlocking the potential of what we've seen hitherto in investment, in work patterns, and in community. If we can think of, if we can create a money system, a sovereign money system, in which it's possible for governments to spend into their social infrastructure, in which it's possible for them to build this potential for work in the way that we've talked about it, in which it's possible for them to guide investment into the kinds of assets that build prosperity, then we are a long way towards the kinds of foundations that I've been talking about. None of them, of course, is particularly easy. There are examples of each of them, even of money. Actually, Iceland, the Netherlands, Switzerland all have political processes at the moment to look at the development of sovereign money systems. There are, in the meantime, of course, lots of other smaller things you can do around community funding, around local currency schemes. At the end of the day, though, it seems to me that unlocking the potential for this economy of tomorrow, an economy that works, depends on actually some quite fundamental reforms of this nature. The idea of money as a social good, work as participation, enterprise as service, investment as commitment, and money as a social good. A sense of an economy of care and craft and culture that sits firmly within our frame of what prosperity actually means. Jim mentioned that I have been working on the macroeconomics of that along with a number of colleagues. I don't want to turn this into a lecture on macroeconomics at this time in the evening. I suspect it would be an unwelcome intrusion in your rush towards the reception and the joys that will follow that. But I did want to show you, I wanted to first frame the idea that this is a meaningful question. Because when I visited the Treasury on the back of the SDC report, there was absolutely no doubt in any of the minds of the Treasury officials that we were talking absolute nonsense. But in an economy which isn't growing anyway, in which the prospects for labour productivity growth are falling, in which its impacts on the environment are unacceptable, which is declining resource base, and which isn't generating quality of life in the most fundamental services, these questions become absolutely paramount. How can we create that macroeconomics Isn't low growth inherently unstable? Doesn't it create rising inequality, as Piketty argued? How do you maintain employment in this economy? Isn't there a fundamental aspect of credit creation and interest charging that builds a growth imperative into the economy? And along with a few economists, we have been looking at these kinds of questions, if you like, as a kind of plan B. Maybe we'll get growth back again. Maybe we'll solve all our problems. Maybe we'll decarbonize everything. But maybe we should be thinking about these questions as well, because they might just turn out to be essential. And what's been fascinating about that is that each turn you're faced with kind of impossibility theorems. If you have an interest-bearing credit, then you have to have a growth-based economy. It's been around for 20 or 30 years, even in the green literature, interestingly, and has been held up as one of the things that you'd have to do before you could get even close to a post-growth economy. So Peter Victor and myself looked at that question, a number of these other questions as well, and asked the question, actually, could we have a steady-state economy? Does it make any sense? Can we maintain stability in such an economy? So essentially, you could think of an economy like this one. Not much happens in terms of the GDP. It's just flat along the baseline, something like Herman Daly's steady state economy. We want to make sure it's resilient, so we're going to shock it out of its comfort and see what happens when we get a little bit further down the line. And what's interesting is, in spite of the creation of credit, which we allowed in the model, in spite of the charging of interest, which we allowed in the model, so basic capitalist infrastructures, there is nothing sitting there ruling out the possibility of a relatively quasi-stable stationary state with interest-bearing credit. One of those answers to one of those questions just ticked off. Could we make it unstable, we asked ourselves. Well, the reality is, and I would be dishonest to say otherwise, is yes, you could. If you increase what Keynes called animal spirits in the model, which is the tendency of people to invest, over-invest when things look like they're going well and under-invest when things like they're going badly, then yes, you can turn that restabilization effect into something which is beginning to look, and I can tell you because I've looked at the graph going on, it gets very unstable and basically collapses the economy. What on earth could you do about that? We went back to Hyman Minsky and to John Maynard Keynes, and we said, what would be the response of a Keynesian or Hyman Minskyan response to this? And Minsky had this wonderful idea about employment as a government as employer of last resort, and about spending in counter-cyclically to stabilize economies. So we simply put a counter-cyclical spending into the economy from government, and extraordinarily, you can get a more stable return, a faster return to stability, by just asking government to do this one simple counter-cyclical thing. And this is a part of the nature of new understandings about monetary systems and the relatedness between economic sectors that has emerged in the wake of the financial crisis, and our ability actually to show this. It's not the answer to all those tough questions. It's the beginnings of saying those impossibility theorems don't always hold up. And it's the beginnings also of a vision of government, of the state itself, as a progressive actor in society. Government money is not the same as household money. Government spending is not the same as household spending. And everything that's been said about that relationship by people who wanted to justify austerity is in fact completely wrong. The government has a monetary power that does not rest in households. It has given over that power to private interests for the sake of short-term gains, electoral gains, and power. And that is an entirely unnecessary position for the state to be in. So coming out of this idea, actually, is the idea of a state that is entrepreneurial, as Mariana Mazzucati has said, that is progressive in terms of its social aims, that is empowered in terms of its monetary ability, and that can act as a guardian of prosperity in the sense in which we've described it here. A huge potential for the renovation of the idea of governance and government. Very last thought experiment. Ultimately, what are we talking about here? Is it possible for us as people to live lives where we have more fun with less stuff? Here's my thought experiment. This is where we are now, in the middle of this diagram. The graph has fun and stuff on it, as you would expect. And the direction of travel, broadly speaking, a business as usual, BAU trajectory, we look as though we might be able to have a bit more fun with a bit more stuff for a little bit longer. But the reality of environmental impacts and resource degradation and the lessons of the limits to growth debate for 44 years, 45 years, suggests actually that that strategy has its limits. We could argue, of course, that we should just cut down everything, cut back everything, hair shirt culture, let's stop the whole process. And of course, we could get to a less stuff position there, but would it be much fun? Probably not. Where do we want to be? Of course, we want to be in the lower right quadrant here somewhere with much less stuff and much less fun. And there are two competing visions for getting there, really. One is a much more fun. Thank you very much. Yeah, that was a terrible mistake. The roots of my Presbyterian upbringing are coming through now. Much less fun. I've failed miserably in this audience already because you're laughing at me. High tech is the default option to there. But one of the ways of exploring along the lines of the fact that it's not the materials themselves, but our identity that's at stake, our participation that's at stake, our health and our fitness that are at stake, is the possibility that we could actually have something that was more around the concept of slow living. Now, I present these very, very simplified scenarios to my students sometimes, and what's really interesting is that there's always a split. Some people actually will love the high-tech one and say, yeah, that's the way to go, and others will love the slow living one. And the reality, of course, is that we have the potential to do both of these things, but we have to build in order to achieve that economies that are fit for purpose. And that does mean revisiting our assumptions about enterprise, about work, about investment, and about money. I'm going to stop there because it would be lovely to have some conversations with you. I'll just point you to the work that we're doing at the Centre for the Understanding of Sustainable Prosperity. And you can see from our themes that this is a truly multidisciplinary task. We sit actually in the Department of Faculty of Physical Sciences and Engineering in Surrey, but a lot of what we're looking at is social science. It is understanding ourselves, it's understanding society, it's understanding the nature of economic systems and their embeddedness in communities. It's ultimately asking questions about meaning, about what our lives and our working lives are for and how we articulate that. And it's asking questions too about art, about our creativity, about our sense of craftsmanship in the world, and the benefits that flow from that. So this is a truly multidisciplinary environment. We also have a lot of work that is done hand in hand with industry, with the Aldersgate Group, for example, is one of the partners in the centre, with civil society organisations, with government. One of our tasks is to provide the secretariat for the All-Party Parliamentary Group on Limits to Growth, and so on and so forth. It's a research agenda for the 21st century, which I believe we're at the beginnings of rather than at the ends of. The scope for the work that's involved in this particular task is, of course, huge. It has an incredibly long pedigree. And I just want to end, really, with this quote. I am not charmed. This is a very famous economist. I'm not charmed with the ideal of life held out by those who think that the normal state of human beings is struggling to get on, trampling, crushing, elbowing, and treading on each other's heels. I rather think that the best state for human nature, said this economist, is that which, while no one is poor, no one desires to be richer, nor has any reason to fear being thrust back by the efforts of others to push themselves forward. It's an idea of thinking about the role of the economy differently. And what's interesting about this last statement is that this economist doesn't say the most likely state of human nature is this one. He says it's the best state of human nature, something to aspire to, something that is different from the assumptions built into conventional economics, something on which to build a different kind of economics. And this is not a degrowth protagonist. This is not a radical Marxist. This, in fact, is John Stuart Mill, the father of modern economics and understanding that dates back over 150 years, 160 years. The agenda asks questions about who we are, ultimately. What economics tells us is that we're broadly selfish. But philosophy, literature, poetry, religion, psychology, sociology argue that that has never actually been the case. The evolutionary evidence for the fact that we are other-regarding social beings is enormous. And equally, economics tells us that we are basically hedonistic novelty seekers. The evidence from all of those other places reflects that tradition matters to us, that conservation is important, that our sense of our ancestors and our inheritance, our children and our grandchildren are always a part of our deliberations, of our concerns. It's a more rounded sense of who we are as human beings. And the idea that we are locked into this upper right quadrant of novelty seeking, selfish, hedonistic consumerism is purely a construct of a defunct view of economics. Our task, it seems to me, is to build out from that defunct view into something which has real foundations for prosperity tomorrow. And the best news of all from that process is, in fact, that rather than constraining our sense of who we are as human beings in order to achieve that, we have the possibility of opening it out into a more meaningful vision, both of prosperity and of ourselves as human beings. Thank you very much for your attention.